Thank you, ladies. That was beautiful. And good morning, everybody, and welcome to Lighthouse Bible Baptist Church, and Merry Christmas to you all. In the way of announcements for today, Pastor Young will be preaching this morning, and this evening we will be having a candlelight service. We normally have services at 6 p.m., but tonight it will be 7 p.m., candlelight service, and if you can make it out tonight and hear a good message and some Christmas singing, I'm sure it'll be a blessing to you. I might be mistaken here, but it says Wednesday evening we have Awana. I believe there is no Awana this coming Wednesday, but we still do have a Bible study at 7 p.m., which Pastor Young will be taking care of for us. Next Sunday, New Year's Eve already, December 31st, we're going to have combined services. So after the morning service, there's actually going to be a ham dinner. And that is going to be taken care of by Chuck Paparone and Ron Pizzangrilli. They're going to be doing all the cooking. And that's out of the goodness of their heart that they're doing all this for us. And we appreciate them very much. But they're asking if they could get some help to set up, serve, and clean up. They would greatly appreciate that if you're able to help out. And we're also going to have our yearly New Year's Eve video to recap the year and everything that went on at Lighthouse. So if you could be here next Sunday for that, to ring in the new year. All right, so January's got a lot going on. Senior Saints Luncheon, Friday, January 5th. The theme is Happy Birthday to All. So if you got a late birthday, you're going to celebrate early. So please bring a crock of soup or a plate of sandwiches to share, and dessert will be cake and ice cream for birthdays. Wednesday, January 10th, there's going to be an after-hours prayer meeting. So after the evening service, there's going to be a prayer meeting. So stick around for that on the 10th. We're going to have another bowling outing on Saturday, January 20th. There's a sign-up sheet for that. A lot of things coming up in February and March as well. We're going to have our Valentine's dinner again this year. We're going to have that at Proietti's Restaurant on February the 10th. Youth Ablaze, February 22nd through the 24th. And I know there's a lot of men waiting for this one, the Meat Feast. It's back. And that's going to be Saturday, March the 2nd. So you've got plenty of time to invite people to come to that. And we're going to have a special speaker as well. Mr. James Alter will be our speaker. And then the Expound Conference from March 18th through the 19th. Last thing, I don't have all the details on this, but I believe there is a table set up out by our track rack near the coat room. There's a table there for the women's prayer partners. I'm assuming if you were not able to get here yesterday, ladies, and you want a prayer partner, there is a form to fill out on there, and there will be some more information at that table for you. That is all I have for announcements. Thank you.
beautiful. We have a music special by the Amslers at this time. You guys want to come and sing?
Your baby boy will one day walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy has come with daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you shall soon deliver you.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know
one last time. Take our hymn books, turn to 196. 196. That was beautiful, guys. Thank you. 196. Let's sing together, Angels We Have Heard on High. 196.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain. And the mountains in reply echo back their joyous strains. Gloria Deo. Shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? Say, what may the tidings be which inspire your heavenly song?
Special at this time.
Well, good morning and Merry Christmas. Evelyn, you want to introduce us to these two handsome men in uniform?
You know I do. God has blessed me with not only four beautiful daughters, but they gave me 15 beautiful grandchildren.
Oh, praise God.
She's the mother of the first three that are in the armed services. I have two in the Army, one in the Navy, and I couldn't be prouder. I know my dad's having a blast up north. He's saying, those are my boys. But this is Chance, the youngest, and this is Kendall, the second youngest.
All right.
I'm thankful for them.
Amen.
But I'm grateful for them that they came. The only thing I asked for Christmas was for my family to be here.
Oh, praise God.
And they've great. Given me the one thing that I value above everything else.
Amen.
Amen. I told the boys they were standing out front. I said, you're going
to
make your grandma cry, you know.
And
she wasn't out of the car. She's getting out of the car. Her eyes are beet red and tears streaming down her cheeks. And so thank you for making grandma's day, gentlemen. And we appreciate your service. Luke chapter number 2. Luke chapter number 2. We're going to look at the Christmas story today in the gospel according to Luke. And let me tell you, parents, it's a wonderful portion of Scripture, the first 20 verses. And if you can, read this tomorrow morning before you open gifts. Okay? So my kids, traditionally, they have to endure the first 20 verses of Luke chapter number 2 before they get to open gifts on Christmas morning. But it's a good portion of Scripture, and we're going to look at it this morning. So Luke chapter 2, and if you find your place there, let's stand for the reading of God's Word, and we're going to read from verse 1 down through verse number 20. It says, "And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, unto Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that, while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even to Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in the manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them." And let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask this time as we're in the Word of God and looking at this miraculous, amazing, prophetic fulfillment of God with man, Emmanuel, God with us, God come to save mankind. and a wonderful thing we get to observe together as a church family. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you for just this opportunity and this special season where even human government here in our nation observes this time where we recognize the coming of God. And Lord, we thank you for this account that we've just read. I pray that you would bless our minds and our hearts to be focused upon your word this morning. I pray that you would help us just to get a vision and a glimpse of this glorious event. Lord, I pray that you would help us see our own lives in light of the Christmas story. We pray in Jesus' name and for his sake, amen. You may be seated. So Luke chapter number 2, that portion of scripture, you know, if you watch the Peanuts Christmas story, you know, this is read here and read in our households and in our homes, and it's a sentimental portion of scripture because we tie this portion of scripture into just a, for many of us, a great time in our life. If you were to describe your life, you would probably point to many different Christmases and occasions where you're together with family and you break bread with each other. And then also another thing that you do at this particular time period is that you have an excuse to buy the ones you love gifts. And you can put thought and effort into it and express your love this way by opening up gifts. And then another sentimental reason to enjoy Christmas is a paid holiday.
Yeah.
You get to stay home and get paid. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that, does it? But this Christmas account was used not just for sentimentalism, but it also is an account to show us the involvement of heaven upon the earth, and then also the great divine miracle where God became flesh and dwelt among men. And restudying this account here this week and just looking at this account, I'm tying this morning's message in with a series of sermons I plan on starting next week. We're going to have about a six-part series, and it's going to be 2024 Survival Kit. Okay.
Right.
Say, what's special about 2024? I'll tell you. You know, a little girl asked her father, said, do all fairy tales begin with, is it just fairy tales that begin with once upon a time? He said, no, honey. He said, there's another thing that begins that way. Once I am elected, I will... You know, we're coming into a presidential election year, and 2024 is going to be interesting,
yes,
to
sir.
Say the least. It always is. Every 4 years, you better buckle down. You better fasten your seatbelts. And in this morning's account, I want you to notice four survival lessons from the Christmas story. First thing I want you to notice, there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And it's always important in days like this to remember that there has always been days like this. So here's your first lesson this morning from the Christmas story. In times of human chaos, God is working behind the scenes.
Amen.
God uses the tyranny of human government, and this is exactly what it is in the land of Israel. They were occupied by foreign armies and by foreign empire. And here you imagine the hardship of Joseph taking his pregnant espoused bride and taking her on this journey back to his hometown. For what purpose? To be taxed, of course, right? It's tax season. And so we see the providential order in the midst of human chaos. Verse number 1, and it came to pass in those days, there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. We live in a fallen world. And the Bible says this, it says, the wicked is as a troubled sea, there is no rest for the wicked. And many times in the scripture, humanity itself is mentioned as an ocean, as a sea, being tossed one direction and another direction. And the wicked rulers that rise up out of the ocean are called beasts. Okay, we see a beast rising out of the chaos of the ocean and these human leaders. And Daniel tells us long before it happened, the different empires that would be in place. And God had an amazing plan. And it says, when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman and made under the law. Well, here's what had taken place in human empires, is that there was a man by the name of Alexander the Great, a Greek, and he conquered the whole then known world. Remember that he wept when he got to the end of the world because there was no other realms to conquer. He conquered it all. And he established learning centers throughout the whole world and the whole region at that time. And the whole world spoke one language, or the trade language was Greek. And that's what the New Testament of your Bible was going to be printed in the realm of Greek. And then rose a Roman Empire. All roads lead to Rome. The Apostle Paul and other preachers, as God said, go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. There was going to be one world language and there was going to be one world power. And the Apostle Paul, with his Roman passport, could go into any nation, any people group, and communicate them the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. And this was the fullness of time. And so you see the tyranny of human government. And I imagine people were worried at this time and fretful and never knowing. There's different uprisings going up and different tyrannical leaders, but God was in the midst the whole time. And by sending Mary and Joseph down to Bethlehem, he was going to be, Caesar Augustus was going to be fulfilling Scripture. Here's what the Bible says about those who are in power. It says in Proverbs 21:1, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and as rivers of water he turneth it whithersoever he will. Psalms chapter number 2 tells us about a global conspiracy that has been going on from ages past into this present age. Is there going to be conspiracies this next year? You better believe it. The Bible tells us that there are. Listen to this, Psalms 2, 1 through 4. Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder. Let us cast their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. It was said to Moses in Exodus chapter number 7 about Pharaoh. He said this. He says, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and I will multiply my signs and my wonders in the land of Egypt. Tyrannical control, tyrannical government, God is going to work in the midst. Mm-hmm. Here's what Nebuchadnezzar, the ruler of Babylon, said. And here's his life lesson in Daniel chapter number 4. He said this, here is the head of gold ruler of Babylon. He says, the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and giveth it to whomsoever he will and sitteth up over it the basest of men. We got terrible rulers. Well, guess who put the basest of men in control?
That's right.
God did. Yeah. Guess who's working behind the scenes according to his divine plan? God is. And God is working through human chaos, and then also God is working according to his word. When Jesus was born in Bethlehem, he was born in accordance to Scripture, born in accordance to prophecy. And here's what prophecy is. It's history told before it happens. That's what prophecy is. And here's what Isaiah says, 700 years before the Savior came. And therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and thou shalt call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. God is going to come and he is going to dwell with men, and he is not going to be born after Adam. He is going to be the second Adam from above, and he is going to be born of a virgin. His name will be Emmanuel. Here's what the prophet Micah says in Micah 5:2. But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be the little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall come forth unto me that is to be a ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from old, from everlasting. lasting. Remember the wise men go into Herod, and they think if anybody knows where the king is going to be born, it's going to be Herod. And Herod doesn't know the Bible, but he calls in the scholars and says, where is Messiah going to be born? The scholars knew immediately, going to be born in Bethlehem of Judea, according to the scripture. John 7:42, it says this, hath not the scripture said that Christ cometh of the seed of David and out of the town of Bethlehem where David was? God's working behind the scenes. So divinely guided by the chaos of other people. A lot of times we feel like victims of other people's behavior and other people's choices, but in all actuality, if we're submitted to God, God uses other people's bad behavior to divinely guide us into the right moment, into the right time. In verse number 2 here of our text, it says, and this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria, and all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. So number one thing here is that God is working in the midst of human chaos. And you and I need to remember this. Number two is that God works through the family. God works through the home. God was going to use a man and a woman and a child together as a family unit. And here was the first Christmas home. First we see Joseph. Here's what the Bible says about Joseph. In the Gospel of Matthew, it records this. Now, Matthew 1:18, it says, now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived of her is of the Holy Ghost. So you can imagine, gentlemen, you can imagine being engaged. Imagine this, John. You find a woman of your dreams. Beautiful blind woman. She don't know what she looked like. And you're a spouse to her. You're going to be married to her. Hopes and dreams and white picket fence and two-car garage and, you know, all the dreams of that day and age. And then she has this announcement. You're not going to believe it. And no, he did not believe it. I mean, 700 years from Isaiah chapter number 7 to this present day, and I mean, thousands of babies been born, and none of them virgin birth, okay? And it just so happens that your espoused fiance comes to you with this announcement that I am a child of the Holy Ghost, and the angel Gabriel, the messenger of Israel himself, came and brought to me this divine message, and Joseph did the same thing that you and I and any other man would have done. Yeah, right. I don't believe it. But here is one comment about this man in the house. It says he was a just man. This means that this was a man of moral integrity, that he was going to do what is right, even in a hard circumstance. And I like here God's behavior when he lets him think about it for a while to see if he's going to do what is right. And he says he was minded to put her away privately or privily. He could have caused great problems for Mary by going public with what took place here. But instead, he was going to do what is right, and God let it sweat it out. He was in God's gymnasium before God comes and reveals unto him, yes, Mary is telling the truth. And so he was a just man. And then there was also here Mary, the blessed woman. And she was submitted to the Lord. She loved the Lord. And when the Lord comes and reveals this unto her, notice that she has a choice. And she says, be it unto me as thou wilt. And so here she was, a blessed woman that was submitted to her Savior, and she was going to give birth to her sovereign. She was going to give birth to her Creator. She was going to give birth to her King. She was going to give birth to her Christ. And she submitted herself. She said, my plans are off to the side, and Lord, I'm going to let you write the story of my life.
Praise God. Amen.
And so she gives God the pen and says, you can write the script for my life. She was submitted to God. And so you have a just man and a blessed woman, and you think about the integrity of Joseph. He has got to take a 9-month pregnant woman on an 80-mile trip. Now, it'd be tough enough to take a 9-month pregnant woman on an 80-mile car trip, right? She's on the back of a donkey.
Yeah, man.
And I was thinking about this, Jamie. You know what their first fight was? Here's what I think it was. So she's like a mama grizzly, right? I mean, she's riding up on the back of it, and she's irritable. She's uncomfortable. You know, she's got aches and pains. And I've gone through this 3 times, so I'm speaking from experience here, okay? And however, with Joseph, you know, I can picture him saying, you know, she's complaining there from the back of the donkey, and he said, not my fault. And you know what? I can picture her saying, if you say it's not my fault one more time, I'm going to come off of this donkey and strangle you. And so you could imagine these two human beings living, you know, in reality 101. And there's going to be discomfort. This couple, let me tell you, it's going to be 30 years before they see Christ's first miracle. They're going to have to live on this divine promise and the promise of Holy Scripture, and they're not going to see another supernatural miracle for 30 years. It's just like those wise men. You know, the star doesn't always shine. Now, the wise men knew about the Christ that was going to come because he had believers like Daniel and others there in the realm of Babylon. They knew that the Messiah was going to come on the scene at any moment. And they finally see his star and they follow his star. And then guess what happens? The star is gone. What do we do now? And they're searching for the Messiah. 30 years, they're going to have faithful service unto the Lord. You're going to see Mary in the book of Acts, chapter number 1, and she continues after she sees her son. Remember Simeon in the temple, he says to Mary, he looks at her, he says, a sword shall pierce through thy own soul as well. And some of you mamas know the pain and the agony of burying one of your own children. And there's no wound like that for a mother. Yet she sees her son die on the cross. She sees him resurrected. She sees him go back to heaven. And you see Mary faithfully serving the Lord in the upper room. She's in that prayer meeting with the other 120. Yes, and just think about this just man, Joseph. He never got to see Christ's ministry. He was off the scene. Most likely he was died sometime in Christ's birth. And he is just a faithful father figure that is going to do what is right according to his family. And here you have a blessed mother who is submitted to the Father's will. And then, of course, you see the Christ child inside the home. And he as well is submitted to the Father. We see him in the end of Luke chapter number 2 that he's in the temple. He's a 12-year-old boy, and he's debating and asking questions of the scribes and of the scholars. Mama comes back and finds him after she lost him for 3 days. What know you not that I must be about my Father's business? But then it says he submitted himself to his parents. And this is the first home. God uses families, and he uses them in a supernatural way. In the midst of turmoil, everybody's worried about what's going to happen tomorrow, and there's only one person that knows, and that's God.
That's right. Amen.
We don't know what tomorrow's going to bring forth. I don't know what kind of Christmas you're going to have. Sometimes we say, it's not going to be a good Christmas this year. What do we mean by that? We don't have much moolah this year. But here was a good Christmas, and it was a Christmas in a manger, inside of a where they keep animals, inside of a modern-day equivalent to a barn. Winston Churchill, in 1941, risked his life to sail the Atlantic and come stateside and try to win support for his family during this tumultuous time in world history. The Prime Minister spoke to a Christmas Eve crowd in 1941, Christmas Eve, of over 20,000 people, and also by radio he spoke this, and here was his remarks. Here in the midst of raging war, raging and roaring over all the lands and the seas, creeping nearer to our hearts and homes here amid all the tumult. We have tonight the peace of the Spirit in each cottage home, in every generous heart. Here, then, for one night only, each home should be a brightly lighted island of happiness and peace. Let me challenge each and every one of us that our homes for the season, our prayer should be that they would be a lighted island of happiness and peace. God uses the home. Point number three, we're going to tie in the home to the next point, that there is a heavenly host. There is a heavenly host of angels. Since we live in this realm, and we don't live in the unseen realm, and we, our eyes, the veil has not been pulled back, a lot of times we sing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, In Excelsis Deo, and all these particular things, but we just, in our eyes, as we read through the Christmas story, we ignore a prominent part of this Christmas story, and that is God's heavenly host. Look, if you will, back to our text. It says in verse number 6, And so it was while they were there, the day should be accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in that same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, good will toward men. Here's a few things about angels. Angels, the Bible tells us, are our fellow warriors. We see in Daniel chapter number 10 that Daniel is praying for 3 full weeks before he gets an answer for the Lord concerning his people Israel that he's praying for.
Yeah.
And then when the messenger finally breaks through, he says, I came to thee at your first request, but the prince of Persia withstood me. There was some sort of demonic realm, demonic angel that withstood his prayer being answered. And I sent for Michael the archangel, and he came and fought against the prince of Persia. And I came through with the message, and now I am going to go and return unto fight. You know what host has to do with? Heavenly host has to do with military. It has to do with being a soldier. And this heavenly host is an encampment around the Son of God as he is born. We see King Hezekiah. He lays out the threat from the king of Assyria before the Lord. And the Lord answers his prayer and sends out one angel, and one angel kills 180,000 Assyrians, and then all of Israel got to go and spoil the military and take all their goods unto themselves. That was one angel. Now, when Jesus was on the cross, he said this. He says, I could ask my Father, and he could call 12 legions of angels. 12 legions of angels would be 72,000 angels. So if one angel could kill 180,000, just imagine what 12 legions of angels could do. The Bible says that we're made just a little bit lower than the angels. So the private first class angel could whoop the fire out of all of us in a room. They're God's warriors. We are connected to them by praying and by prayer. These messengers deliver answers to us by way of praying. 1 Corinthians chapter number 10, verse number 11. You can look this up and explain this to me later. I could tell you what it is. Okay, so let me tell you what it is. In this particular day and age, we're talking about the home and how God works through the home. Okay? So women in this day and age, remember in Luke chapter number 14, this is the chapter of the lost things, and the one woman loses a coin, and she's sweeping her house and looking for this coin. Well, this coin would have belonged in her head covering. This would have been similar to our wedding ring, and this would have been a sign of her marriage, and this would have been a very, like, the most important piece of jewelry to her. This belonged to her headdress, and when she wore her head covering, she identified herself as a married woman, and she identified herself with her husband. And so in 1 Corinthians 11, 10, Paul says to those who have this tradition of head covering once you get married, he says, did you know that a married woman not wearing her head covering is a dishonor to her husband? And he says, so when you pray, wear that head covering. And it says, for the angels. You know what it says in 1 Peter chapter number 3?
What?
About your husbands? Husbands, dwell with your wife according to knowledge and honor her as the weaker vessels. It says, lest your prayers be hindered. The angelic beings are partners in prayer, and the angelic beings understand and honor rank and order, and they understand the dignity of the home. So when we're up here marrying two people, what God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. It is a holy and it is a divine union that even the angels of heaven recognize. They are fellow warriors, that they are part of the family of God. They're not human beings. They're angelic beings, not human beings, but they're part of the greater family of God. Another thing about these angels, not only are they warriors, they're also worshipers. In Revelation chapter number 5, it says that there was 10,000 times thousands, of which no man could number. So it says these angelic hosts that the human mind can't even wrap their mind around how many there are. And we see them all up in heaven, and they are singing praises unto God and praises unto the Lamb.
Amen.
So here's some shepherds out in the field watching their flocks by night. Now, Bethlehem is right outside of Jerusalem. They would have been watching sheep most likely that are going to go for Passover. You would need 100,000 plus sheep for the Passover sacrifice right outside of Jerusalem. And shepherds there in this day and age, they would have been illiterate. We understand that they could not testify in a court of law. Their testimony would be thrown out. And so they were the lowest rank in that particular society. Remember when Joseph went down to Egypt? He says, don't tell Pharaoh that you're shepherds. Shepherds are an abomination to the Egyptians. So shepherds were transient, again, illiterate. They smelled like sheep. And here are the angels of heaven. They go past Jerusalem. They go past the scribes. They go past the palace. They go past the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all the religious leaders of that day. And they go out to the poorest of the poor, these illiterate shepherds. And it says, and the angel of the Lord came unto them, singular angel. And then it says, the heavens were open and all the hosts of heaven began singing. I've never seen an angel. Okay. But anybody in the Bible who comes across an angel, they always fall flat on their face. It's always very, very intimidating. And then the angel will say something. I am your fellow laborer. Do not worship me. And they don't accept worship because they're a created being like you and I. Get up off your feet. So they see one angel, and this one angel is proclaiming this message to them. And it says they were exceedingly afraid. And you would be too. But then I was trying to picture last night. Here's what they say, glory to God in the highest. And we sang this, our last hymn together. Gloria, in excelsis Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Glory to God in the highest. Last night I was going over this, and so I got on my little music account. I listened to about 10 different artists. I did choir specials and some listened to Glory Day whatever it is, Excelli State Glory. That is Latin. So I'm listening to some Italians sing it, things like that. And I'm trying to picture in my mind, because this is exactly what the angels were singing. Glory to God in the highest. And, you know, I listen to the choir, and if we were in some sort of a, you know, we were at the Eastman Theater, and there was some world-renowned choir there, and they started singing, you know, Glory, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. And, you know what? Our hair would be standing on the back of our neck. All of us. We would be moved by the music. Can you imagine all the heavenly hosts of heaven, all these angels, these fellow worshipers worshiping God? And it says, unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And so all this angelic, powerful, heavenly host is worshiping God, who humbled himself and became a baby in a manger to save humanity. The angel said, unto you is born a Savior. They are excited for the human race that God himself was going to come. And so this is amazing contemplation. And, you know, I think we should think about it. And there's two different individuals that greatly influenced our country, and they're the spiritual fathers of our country. And without these two gentlemen, we would not have a nation of America. And even secular scholars would agree with this. And their names were George Whitefield and John Wesley. And they got together. They knew each other, went to Oxford together. They got together, and they wrote the hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. So here they're thinking, John Wesley and George Whitefield, these two godly men, first great awakening, God used them in a great way. And here they're thinking about Luke chapter number 2, and they're penning this hymn that we still sing today. You can go to a shopping mall and hear Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And here was the words that they came up with. Hark the Herald Angels Sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Amen. Last week we talked about John 1:14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Here's what God did. The Bible says this, no man has seen God and lived. However, God sent forth his Son, the Word, and he was clothed in flesh and made like as Amen. Unto his brethren. So, you know, the S-O-N is very much like the S-U-N. Now, if you go outside, today you could do this, but if it's a cloudless day, you can't just go outside and stare at the sun or it'll burn your retinas. But if you have a proper veil, even on a telescope, you can look, and you can look directly at the sun, and you can see the sun. You know what Jesus said about himself? If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. That here is the miracle that God came in the flesh, and if you want to see how God is, you look at the Lord Jesus Christ and you see how God behaves here. So he says, veiled in flesh the Godhead see, veiled the incarnate deity. And then he says this, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as men with men to dwell. So here's another exciting fact the angels are singing about. The title that Christ used the most regarding himself was Son of Man. Pleased as men with men to dwell. The God celebrated the fact that he was made human and dwelt among men. And so here from the unseen realm, here is a group of angelic heavenly hosts. That the battle is with God, and it's not with us alone, that our spiritual battle includes the angelic realm. We see this unseen realm that touches our realm, that these angelic beings from time to time can come from the unseen to the seen. It says in the book of Hebrews that sometimes we entertain angels unawares. And all these beings come down and sing, "Glory in excelsis Deo." Here's the last thing, we're done. So we see there that in the midst of human chaos, God is working behind the scenes. God is using the institution of the home, and God is using families. Christmas is a time for the family. It is a time for the home. God uses families. God has a heavenly host. They're involved in your life, and you are involved in their reality as you labor together for the Lord, as you war together for the Lord, as you worship the Lord. The angelic host joins in as well. Finally, is this, is here's the heart of Christmas, and the heart of Christmas is having a humble heart. I want you to notice this. Verse 15, "And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And it says, and when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds." And it says, "But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart." The shepherds were already the lowest of the low. And the Bible says this, that God chose the poor, rich in faith. That's right. The Bible says this, is that the common men heard him gladly. People that were already natural humble because of their rank in society, they were the ones that overwhelmingly came and received Christ. And then the Bible says about this who are rich. It is harder for a rich man to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to be saved. Amen. Well, there's a few rich people that are saved. That's right. But a rich person has a temptation to trust in uncertain riches, the Bible says. They're going to be proud. They're going to be proud in their own capacity to take care of themselves. The Bible says this, Sermon on the Mount. Here's how Jesus opens up. Greatest sermon ever preached. Blessed are the poor in heart. Blessed are they that are poor in heart. Shepherds are poor. Joseph and Mary, they were a two-dove family. We see this in Luke chapter number 2. When they went to the temple, they offered up the poorest of the poor sacrifice. They were poor. You know, if you're poor here this morning in one fashion or another, you're at a distinct spiritual advantage. The Bible says, "A little that the righteous hath is better than the riches of many wicked." I have a challenge for you who are highly educated. Might have wealth in the bank, might run a business or something like this, and you're a mover and shaker, your temptation is that you don't really need Jesus. But in our story, there's wise men. They're not here this day. They're going to be coming about 2 years later. You don't have to remove the wise men from your manger scene, but I was telling you. So they're putting aside their riches, and they're getting on the back of camels, you know. We three men from Orientar, you know, they're coming from a long distance, and they're going to humbly seek him, and they're going to humbly worship him. And let me tell you something, is as we say, that the ground is level at the foot of the cross, and everybody gets saved the same way. That's when you come to Jesus with nothing and receive everything. Christmas time, we say that Christmas is the greatest gift ever given. That God so loved the world that he gave free gift, his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Christmas is only finished when we receive the gift of salvation. We receive the gift of Jesus Christ as our Savior. Let me ask you this morning, Angels declared it. Prophets proclaimed it. They said it was happening. Jesus Christ came. Shepherds, it said, they went and saw this great thing. And when they had received it, they went everywhere telling about the Lord Jesus. Let me ask you this morning, have you by faith received the message of Christmas? Have you by faith received the Lord as your Savior, as your Master? Can you rejoice with the angels? Glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let's stop. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for just the message of Christmas and what we get to celebrate here. God among men. What a glorious occasion, what a glorious day it was when Jesus came. And Lord, I pray that you bless each and every one of us. Lord, I pray that you would help us as we respond to your word this morning and all the message of song and things which we've heard. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for watching the sermon today. If you'd like to find out more information about our church, you can visit our church website at lbbc.info. If you'd like to email us, you can email us at mylbbc@gmail.com. I also have a website, pastorjack.org. You can sign up for my blog there. And then also we do have a podcast. It's called the Pastoral Thoughts Podcast, and you can find that on podcast apps, and you can also find that on YouTube. God bless you. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.